First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
No doubt. Be back once again with Dr. Aleem Bey. And tonight's show is going to be on light orbs, macabres, and double suns. Before we get into the information, we want to go over some things. A lot of information has been put out about light orbs, in which that some say is simple dust particles or water particles or whatever the case may be, in which that is caught when someone is taking a picture or shooting a video or whatever the case may be. And then there's cases when these particular orbs are not outside conditions, you know, with dust particles or with water particles. They're inside, and yet they're being taken and filmed. This has yet been able to be deciphered, you know. For the outside, we can contend with the fact that it might be dust particles or water particles. However, inside a particular place, such as a home, apartment, or etc., and these particular pictures are being taken and these light orbs are showing up, it is very hard to state that they have outside influences unless a window is open or some other thing as such. So you're going to get into how authentic is the science of these particular light orbs. We know, for example, that in the occult, the physical body can be transformed into what is called a flaming chariot or macabre. Within the ancient Kemetic teachings, the macabre was spoken of, and the symbol of the macabre, you know, of course, was a geese, symbolic to Geb, in which that was Myrrh, as well as Ka, which is, of course, with the hands up like a field goal, and Ba, which is, of course, the soul, in which that is shown as a symbol of Ra with a dot in the center, or what's called Atun Re, in that regard. So when you look at these particular hieroglyphs or Metuneta, the bird, which is a goose, is shown as, of course, as a form of the soul itself. In other words, being able to take flight. Of course, within the ancient world, we believe as we do now, for those who study the occult sciences, the mystic sciences of out-of-body experiences. All right. Also, the sciences, being able to transform your body into a ship. In other words, expanding your auric field, turning it inside out, in which that you can imagine yourself as a pebble being dropped in a pool of water and the ripples going outward. And then imagine yourself in space and you being dropped in ether and those ripples going outward. This is one of the teachings or one of the techniques in which that was taught to us when we was answered our law, Nubian Islamic Hebrews, up under Imam Isa, a.k.a. Dr. York. And anyone who has studied those particular teachings of the sons and daughters of the Green Light or the ancient mystic order of Melchizedek, or now in the ancient Egyptian order, you would see that those sciences are possible. As a matter of fact, there's another individual by the name of Gervalo Melchizedek, who has both books. It's called The Flower of Life, Volume 1 and 2, in which that he breaks down the 18 breath technique, 24 breath technique, and the 28 breath technique, in which that expands your chakras into the auric field in order to flatten it out 55 feet outside of the perimeter of your physical body. And you sit in the center of a geometrical shape. And based on whatever or whichever particular chakra in which that you actually focus on will give you that particular ability and access. And you can actually travel through vortexes as well as wormholes or whatever case may be. As a matter of fact, if you get the book, Zulu Bone Oracle, portion of it was written by Akuta Mutwa. In there, Akuta Mutwa was interviewed, and he spoke about, or at least I should say he was interviewed, he spoke about that in, according to the AmaZulu people, which are the Sky people, as he's part of, the South Africans, there's a particular story about us coming from Mars prior to coming to this planet. They refer to it as the red planet, and that this is the sixth planet that we have come to. So obviously Mars was the fifth planet that we was on. This is why now, ever since the Viking missions won 1977, you've been able to see these artificial structures on Mars within the Cydonia site, in which that you've been able to see pyramids or mirrors or mirrors. Glass structures, even recent pictures as looking similar to ancient Egyptian, you know, likenesses. They also have a face there on Mars in which that the origin is that supposedly of a woman, you know. Matter of fact, it's a mile high and a mile wide. So you can't help but see this. So there's a lot of things in which that has verified that we have that capability of being able to travel from planet to planet. According to the mythology, or I should say the story of the AmaZulu people, Akuta Mutwa stated that there was destruction within the solar system. And those on the surface of Mars was getting ready to get wiped off. And so the men impregnated the women. And the women was able to transform their bodies into ships and came here to planet Earth to populate. Now, this is the way that the story is told. Of course, there's more, you know, in which that we can read into it. This is why I refer to it as a mythology, because there's more as with most myths, they come from a particular source or origin of reality. We can see that as being true because even in the Bible, they have the story of Ezekiel, Daniel, as well as also of Elijah in particular, in which that Elijah was taken up, all right, into a flaming chariot, hence a macabre. Okay? And he was never seen again because he went to go be with God. All right? So we have another tale of Enoch who walked with God and was never seen again. Then you have the story of Melchizedek, who has no mother nor father, but yet able to reappear and disappear, or what is called materialization and dematerialization. He had those particular abilities. Even Jesus, who was after the order of Melchizedek, according to the stories. Now, of course, this is all allegory, but these are still capabilities or concepts in which that as men and women, we have those abilities. In other words, these stories was characterized based on the physiology and based on astrology or cosmology. All right, as above, so below, as within, so without. So this information is still very valid. Don't throw away the baby with the bathwater. All right, so we're getting ready to bring the brother on. Let me see here.
The plans would increase the cost of the month to charge $125. The agency will hold public hearing next month with the possibility of a fare increase in March of next year.
All right. We still want him to come on. Let me get back into the information. So, Creed of Mutual speaks about this. The Bible speaks about this. And many other cultures have also spoken about this. This is found within the Dogon of Mali, who were the ancient Egyptians who left Egypt around the time of 6,000 BC. So 8,000 years ago, they left Egypt. And they moved westward because of the coming invasion. They was the astrologers or the cosmologists during that day and time, as they still are today. All right? And the Dogon speaks about the fact you get Robert Temple's book, The Serious Mysteries. You can get Murray and Hope book, The Serious Connections. You can also get the Pale Fox book. All three of these particular books speaks about the fact of the Dogon stating that our original home was in the Sirius constellation, and that once again we traveled space and time. As a matter of fact, they still say today that based on the elliptical pattern of Sirius A and Sirius B, it is based on our that our DNA is based on that particular alignment. And you can see that. So every 50 years or so, they go through a year of Jubilee, which is also mentioned in the Old Testament, in which that the Dogon speaks about the fact of these two planets coming together and crisscrossing over each other with tremendous amounts of force. And when they flip-flop over each other, the electromagnetic field is so strong. You know, literally, these planets flip-flop. So, these stars, I should say, flip-flop. All right, and that same elliptical alignment like we're talking about is based on your body structure, your DNA, As a matter of fact, in the Quran, Surah 53, called Najm, the star, it specifically speaks about that Allah is the Lord of the mighty star Sirius. Now, of course, that's a lot, which is a form of offset. Because the star Sirius symbolizes her throne, in which there Osar sits upon, which is known as Sa or Orion. Right? Sirius was known as Saptit within the Metunata. Saptit. And other aspects was that of the child between Nephet and Osar, known as Anpu or Anubis, the black-headed jackal or the black-headed dog, in which that the dog star also symbolizes too. Now, all this got to do with the fact of there's another planet. So you have Zigitolo, Polotolo, and you have Emiya. Now, Emiya is Sirius C. Many have stated that this planet X, or Nibiru, or Nibiru, in which that is returning, or has returned, and some people have taken pictures. Dr. Deborah Blair speaks about this, and have taken pictures of two suns. And according to Zachariah Ascension's teachings, the planet of the crossing, known as Planet X, comes within the solar system every 3,600 years. Well, it's been speculated that this particular planet of the crossing, in which they're referring to, is actually a star, which is Sirius C, Emiya. Hence the return of the mother principle. Emiya is the same as the deity Emiya within the Yoruba traditions, in which that symbolizes one of the Orishas, or is one of the Orishas, one of the goddesses or gods. Now, that symbolizes the return of the feminine principle, and is now being seen behind our sun. So it's the sun behind, it's the sun behind our sun. Now, many speaks about this. If you go to the Masonic text or the Theosophical text or Rosicrucian text, they speak about the sun behind our sun, in which that they say that is Sirius. They just don't mention which Sirius it is. Sirius A, Sirius B, or Sirius C. Sirius A is the brightest of the three. However, now that Sirius C has entered into our atmosphere, now we are seeing it directly behind our particular sun. All right? And this is very powerful. Very powerful. All right? So this is one of the reasons for the mass amounts of corona mass ejections from off the planet, or from off the sun, excuse me, off the yellow sun, our sun. Because there's another sun within the sphere in which that is causing these particular super flares, mega flares, etc. And as this alignment takes place, as we know with our Earth, the Sun, Sirius, the Pleiades in particular, Alcyon, the central Sun in the Pleiades, this is all in alignment right now. This is what is going on in that season right now. And so we are seeing that things have to take place. it is many who have spoken about the 3 days and the three nights on which that will go through darkness, and you will have to raise up your electromagnetic field. And because the Earth electromagnetic field will be lowered, and if you're not able to keep your electromagnetic field raised up during those 3 days and three nights, then you will lose memory during this pole shift, during this particular planetary alignment. This is what is said by many, especially from the indigenous cultures of the world. They all speak about us moving into the fifth world, whether it's the Hopis, whether it's the other Native Americans, whether it's the Africans, the Aborigines. All the indigenous people on the planet speaks about us moving into the fifth world. And as we spoke about and expanded on before, we actually are fourth dimensional beings being locked down by third dimensional beings. And they don't want us to graduate into becoming a fifth dimensional beings, because then we'd be able to see them for who they really are. Because they can't make the transition into the fifth dimension. This is why they interface with fourth dimensional beings in order to get a glimpse of the fourth dimension. And they use them from the first and second overtone level of the astral plane to lock us down. Yet we're greater than all of them. Because we're not just fifth dimensional, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth dimensional beings. We have access through all of these particular portals. We just don't realize it. In other words, we don't have to be locked down. But these fourth dimensional beings attach themselves to these entities on this planet, these soulless beings on this planet, and utilize them as like puppets. And they attach themselves to the first and second chakra, which is hence the reptilian portion of the brain. Because that's what controls the first and second chakras, the reptilian portion, the limbic portion of the brain. And these beings have, hence the reason why they are called reptilians, because that's the area in the brain in which they work off of. And the perception is that of a reptilian, in which that is projected. Because that is the oldest portion of the brain. But it's not the highest. The neocortex and the frontal lobes are the highest portions of the brain. Hence the reason why in Matrix, Mr. Anderson was called Neo, because he symbolized the neocortex. The new mammal brain, the new animal brain, or the higher animal brain. So, we are about to make these transitions. And for those who get locked down or continue to be locked down during these particular alignments, will not make it. So we gave forth a way of expanding your auric field, especially during those particular times when or if they occur. And supposedly it happened between December the 21st through the 24th. We will see. But it's best to be prepared than don't be prepared at all. And the science is that if you do what's called pranic breathing, which is pranayama, yoga, and you do the empty retention breath, or you do the 7171 breath, or you do the 6363 breath, it expands your auric field from 3 feet outside of your physical body to 15 feet. Hence increasing your magnetic properties of your physical cellular structure. life and death happens at these cells, at the cellular structure, or the cellular levels. So by strengthening it, you end disease, confusion, fear, etc. The veil will be lifted from over your eyes and you'll be able to see holistically. So the more you practice this technique or these particular breath techniques, the more you come into that realization. So I recommend two books, Pranic Healing 1 and Pranic or Advanced Pranic Healing 2. Both of them was written by Master Sua Choa. Master Choa. And that's Choa, Master Choa. And he teaches you in there how to project colors upon the auric field of yourself as well as also of others in order to visualize and to heal yourself. Now, what do this all have to do with the macabre? The macabre is the same thing. To expand your auric field, to magnetize yourself to the point where you are able to transcend space and time, to break the threshold of gravity. Gravity is only 7.3. And you can actually break that. That's actually a weak number. And by mastering your macabre, hence your auric field, expansion of your auric field, you can actually break the threshold of gravity. This is what all these sciences are talking about or referring to. All right, so we got some things here in which that we want to go over, because when people think about orbs, they normally relate that to ghosts in the form of balls of light, you know, and they are life forms that travel in groups. So you don't normally see just one light orb. You see several, and they're believed to be the human soul or life force of those who once inhabited a physical body here on Earth. This is what is being speculated. And, of course, psychics claim to talk to them on a regular basis. And, of course, ghost hunters encountered them quite frequently. You know, if you watch any of the TV shows, you know, it is said that they are those spirits that have willingly stayed behind because they have felt bound to their previous life or previous location for whatever reason. Now, I actually been in pictures where there's been orbs. Of course, we didn't know that until after they was developed. My wife has actually seen orbs. I've seen UFOs. There is a correlation between these particular things. A UFO is something in which that normally is meant, as far as definition-wise, unidentified flying object. And a light orb would actually account for something in which that is being unidentified. You don't know what it is. And it's flying in or moving, and it's an object. So actually, a light orb can actually be referred to as a UFO. But what happens is that when you actually transform your body into a macabre, you actually shrink to the size of a ball of light. All right. There's a technique within Qigong in which that is called the ball of light, in which that you actually rotate your hands as you breathe in and out in a circular manner, like you are holding a ball. And then actually after you finish rotating the rotating it back and forth, you actually can take the energy and place it within your dantian, which is your lower dantian in particular, which when you place energy into your lower dantian, you extend your life force. you live longer, you live healthier. If you do it at the heart, then you expand the frequency of love, compassion, mercy, right. If you do it at the third eye, then you expand your IQ, your intelligence, your memory. Especially if you do it at the back of the head, which is the back of the third eye, you can actually activate components of your past life, as well as also photographic memory. So this is what these sciences are actually about. Now, we spoke about this before, that 300,000 tons of stardust energy or cosmic dust energy falls to the planet Earth daily. In some regards, these particular balls of light are actually made up of these particular star particles. This is what scientists, quantum physicists already realized and have stated, that the human body is actually a walking star. And of course, you know, that's the outer shell. But the inner shell will also have to be shown forth as a star. And that is this particular light orb, or macabre, or UFO as it is referred to as. Now, you can wait to master this after death, which most do. Hence the reason why they have to incarnate over and over again. Or you can master it while you are still alive and learn how to do the macabre techniques, in which we spoke about the 18, 24, and 28 breath technique by studying Gervalo Melchizedek on the Flower of Life techniques, in which that he will actually take you through that. I've actually gone through that particular school and been initiated. And I also teach those particular sciences, especially in our courses of the Halo Wings Institute, in which that is 3 months, and we certify you through Qigong, Tai Chi, Reiki, Pranic Healing, and the different forms of Reiki is Ushi Reiki, Tibetan Reiki, Shekin Reiki, Pranic Healing, which is Pranayama, Yoga, which is part of Kundalini Yoga, which is also Tantra Kriya Yoga, or Tantra Kriya Yoga, known as Naga Yoga, you know, as well as also irisology, in which that we can look into the eyes and actually see what diseases are showing up within the body prior to the physical manifestation of them. And diagnose and show what herbs in which that can be utilized in order to help remedy the ailment, sickness or disease. Herbology or herbalism, in which that we go through, and which that teach these particular sciences of how to identify particular herbs, how to make tinctures, teas, powders, etc. So we teach all of this information in the Halo Wings Institute, in which I'm the president of. So anybody who is interested, can actually give us a call at 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588. We got a lot of information. Y'all see the information that we be dropping on throughout the shows. Let me put it this way. This is nothing. When we get in class, we go all out. And we go through the information. We dig and we practice, practice, practice. That's the science of study self. That's why I was all up over Kemet. Know thyself. And by knowing thyself, you will know God and the universe. So, let's get back to this science here. We're talking about the word macabre. And of course, that's Hebrew for what we're saying about flaming chariot. Also means to ride an animal or in a chariot. All right. So in Ezekiel, we talk about first chapter, the 4th through the 26th verse. It refers to the throne of the chariot of God, which is talking about the will within the will, We spoke about that a little bit earlier, in which that is symbolic to those four faces of man, lion, ox, or calf, which is the bull, and the eagle, which is nothing more than the man is, of course, is Aquarius. The lion is Leo. The ox, calf, or bull is Taurus. And the eagle is Scorpio. We're talking about the four points of the zodiac. In this particular all right, that's what it means. So, when you transform your body into a macabre, you can actually control time itself. All right, if you ever seen the movie, oh man, what's the name of that movie? In the movie, we'll put it this way. It come to me in a second here. In the movie, the guy said that he traveled from his planet to the planet Earth on a beam of light called tachyon energy. All right? That's what he said. That he traveled from his planet to the planet Earth on a beam of light called tachyon energy. All right? Tachyon energy is actually faster than light itself. We know that thought travels at 24 billion miles per second. Light travels at 186,000 miles per second. Sound travels at 1,120 feet per second. So we know that thought travels faster than light. Tachyon energy goes into that realm above light, into the realm of thought. And when you're dealing with the signs of the macabre, this is actually where you want to get to be. Now, when you look at the macabre, of course, the macabre is a divine light vehicle. It is used supposedly by the ascended masters to connect with and reach those in tune with the higher realms. You know, mer means light, ka means spirit, and like you said, ba means soul, or in reference to the body itself. In other words, your melanin. So macabre means the spiritual body surrounded by the kind of rotating fields of light, will within the will, hence your chakra system, which is known as your particular will. So the will within the will, your chakra is within your auric field, which is also a will, or looks like a will. It's the spiraling energy as in DNA that transport the spirit and the body from one dimension to another. So in moderate, I guess you can say, esoteric teachings, it is taught that the macabre is also an interdimensional vehicle consisting of two equal sides of interlocked tetrahedrons of light with a common center where one tetrahedron points up and one tetrahedron points down. This point symmetric form is called a stellar octala, all right, or what is known as an octahedron. Which is also to be obtained by extending the faces of a regular octahedron until they intersect again. All of this is a fancy way of saying is that at 19 degrees or 19.5 degrees is the upswelling of energy in the south, which is known as your kundalini. However, at 19.5 degrees in the north is also an upswelling of energy, which is in your pineal gland, which is your soul. So your Holy Spirit, which is your kundalini, must raise up, be that upswelling energy to connect to awaken our soul, the resurrected one or the ascended one, in order to give you that out-of-body experience, which is through the right articular section of the brain, which is in the right hemisphere of the brain itself. But not just have out of body experience, but it actually able to merge the spirit in the body or the ba and the ka. Remember, the ba and the ka was the two bodies in which that was being formed on the will of Kanun, a form of Amen, on his potter's will. It is a known fact that the Bible says that you was made from the dust of the ground, Adam, as well as also In the Quran, it speaks about the man or woman being made from black mud. So this is all similar to that science or what we're talking about here. By imagining the two superimposed star tetrahedrons as counter-rotating fields, along with a specific pranic breath technique, all right, and certain eye movement and mantras or mudras, it is taught that one can activate a non-visible, saucer-shaped energy field around the body that is anchored at the base of the spine. All right, this is what is taught. This is why we was talking about getting the information on the technique. Now, depending on the height of the person doing exercise, the field is about 55 feet across. Once activated, this saucer-shaped field is capable of carrying one's consciousness directly to higher dimensions. Now, if there's two people, actually they can actually take 144,000 with them. If a male and a female in particular expand their auric fields and they merge their macabre field, they can actually take 144,000 people with them. All right. Now, another thing about the signs of the macabre is actually the breath technique. It's basically teaching on the breathing or using the 18 breaths. And you know, there's 17 plus one breaths. So it says where there is actually the first six are based on balancing the polarity. The next seven, the proper pranic flow through the entire body. And the further breaths are for shifting the consciousness from the third to the fourth. And we're going to do the fourth to the fifth dimension. Finally, the last three breaths is for recreating the rotating macabre within and around the body. The last breath is not taught, all right? So once each day, enter into the into this meditation until the time comes when you're a conscious breather. Remember, with each breath, you connect with God. You become more intimate with God in this way. This is what taps you into your higher self. This is another technique. So in the first breath, you inhale. And you open your heart and you feel love for all life. All right? The mind becomes more aware. And this male tetrahedron, which is the one that points up towards the sun, begins to be filled. And then there's a downward one in which that's symbolic to the female, in which that begins to be filled with the bright white light surrounding the body. And you can visualize it the best you can. But if you can't visualize it, sense it or feel it as it's being surrounded, as it surrounds you. Now the body, at the same moment of inhalation, place your hands in the mudra of your thumb and your first finger touching. Remember, lightly touch your fingers and do not allow your fingers to touch each other or any other object. Keep your palms up. Now when you get into the science of breathing, at the same moment you enter your lungs, begin to breathe in a complete yogic manner. In other words, conscious breath. Breathe through your nostrils only, except in certain places in which that will be described. Simply put the breath from your stomach first, then your diaphragm, and then finally into your chest. Do this in one movement, not in three parts. Right, the breath is then completely either by holding your chest, you exhale and relax the stomach, slowly releasing the air, or by breathing the or by holding the stomach firm and relaxing the chest. The most important aspect is actually to have the breath in a rhythm. All right, that shows the actual breath is by having it in a rhythm. Breathing through your nostrils. Inhale steadily. All right. And when you go through these particular exercises, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but there's 18 of them. The second one deals with the thumb and the second finger together. The second breath mudra. The third breath mudra deals with the thumb and the third finger together. The fourth mudra deals with the thumb and the little finger together. The fifth mudra deals with the first fingers together as the first breath. The sixth one deals with the third, with the thumb and the second finger together. And then once again, all of this goes into the refinement of your auric cell. You know, by this time you'd be on breath seven. And you visualize and sense the tube running through your body. It's known as your pranic tube. Now, in ancient times, it was a known fact that the pranic tube actually was where at the top of the head was that hollow area in the head, or that soft spot area in the head in which that becomes hardened after the age of seven, in which that actually reached down to the perineum, or within the woman is the G-spot area, with about an inch and a half to 3 inches inside of the woman's vaginal area. There's a tube in which that runs up, in which that does not bend, in which that actually you once used to breathe through that pranic tube. You did not breathe the way that you do now, which is through your nostrils. You've actually used to breathe through that particular tube, inhale and exhale. As a matter of fact, the pineal gland used to sit higher up towards the top of the head area. This is why on the walls of ancient Egypt, you see the pine comb on top of the head on some of the Metunetel hieroglyphs. That symbolized the pineal gland. All right? So you will begin to start seeing this brilliant white light of prana moving up and down the tube from the top and up the tube from the bottom at the same time. And this movement is basically instantaneous. And the points are that there's these two light beams meets within your body is controlled by the mind and this vast space between throughout the universe. Now, you want to put this energy at the heart chakra, which symbolizes the fourth dimension. All right? And basically, as this prana sphere continues to grow in shape, it will continue to maximize the size at the end of this breath. The maximized size is different for each person. But if you put your longest finger into the center of your navel, the line of your waist defining your hand will show you the radius and the maximum size of the sphere for you. The sphere of prana cannot grow larger. Now, this pranic sphere cannot grow larger. So what happens is that the pranic begins to concentrate within the sphere. And the visual appears is that the sphere grows brighter. So the sphere grows brighter and brighter as you inhale and exhale. And as you exhale, the sphere continues to grow brighter and brighter. And then you inhale. And about halfway through this inhale, as the sphere grows brighter, the prana sphere reaches the critical mass, and the sphere is ignited into a sun, a brilliant, blinding ball of white light. You know what I'm saying? And then you're ready to go to the next step. You know? And so, it's at this moment of the exhale that the small sphere of, you know, that your body is now completely enclosed within a huge sphere of brilliant white light, and you must return to the ancient form of the spherical breath or breathing exercise. You must breathe three more times to keep this sphere stable. All right, so that's your 11th, your 12th, and your 13th breath is actually to keep it stable. And then by your 14th breath, at the very beginning of the breath, move to the point where the two beams of the prana meets from the navel to the sternum, which is the fourth dimensional chakra. The entire large sphere, along with the original sphere, this is when these two meet or form that tetrahedron. All right. It's at this particular time that the left palm on top of the right palm for the males, and then the right palm on top of the left palm for the females. This is when you do this particular mudra at 14. And then you just do the rhythmic breathing, real deep, and you exhale, And basically you do this particular science until you go into the 15th breath technique, which is when you actually the whole Star Tetrahedra superimposes over each other. And then this is one with the body itself, actually, and it's placed around the body according to the male or the female. And the second whole star tetrahedron is male in nature. It is electrical and is literally the human mind, and it rotates the counterclockwise relative to the body lookout, or as to put it another way, it rotates towards your left side. All right, and then the whole third star tetrahedron is female in nature and is magnetic and is literally the human emotional body, and it rotates clockwise relative to your body lookout. Or as we will put it, it rotates towards your right side. All right, so on the inhale of the 15th breath, as you inhale, you would say to yourself in your head the code words equal speed. And that's how you stabilize this particular macabre. And as it's being stabilized, you're moving now into the 16th breath, in which that, as you let out the breath, the two sets of the tetrahedrons take off from their one-third speed of light, settling on the two-thirds speed of light in an instant. And basically, as they approach the two-thirds speed of light, phenomenon, a disc about 55 feet in diameter forms around the body to the level of the at the level of the base of the spine, and the sphere of energy that is centered around the two sets of the tetrahedrons form within the disc to create a shape that looks like a flying saucer around the body. Now this energy matrix is called the macabre. This is what we're talking about. However, it is not stable. Right, so as you see or sense the macabre around at this point, you would know that to be unstable. As a matter of fact, you would feel, as you are in this particular sphere, you will hear humming noises, a humming sound. You actually feel your body inside of a particular sphere of this energy. You feel this energy all around you, and you stand in the center of it. And this, what I'm talking about, is no bullshit. This is real. And we all going to have to learn how to master these particular sciences so that the people or the beings or the aliens or extraterrestrials, in which everybody been talking about since the biblical days, can actually see a nigga. And what I mean by that is that you have to be able to resonate at a frequency in which that to be seen. Because they're not coming down here into this cesspool to get you. You have to become bright enough and be able to lift off yourself to merge with the Confederation, as we would say. Beam me up, Scotty. All right, and this takes place first within your pineal gland. And right above the pineal gland is a galaxy-like cloud called the fourth eye, in which that the kundalini, as it hits the pineal gland, you have 144,000 sand-like particle lenses, which are magnetized, in which that shoots a beam of light off into this galaxy-like cloud structure or UFO structure in your brain. And if you don't believe me, you can look this you can look this up. It's in Nutrisize by Dr. Layla Africa. In the book, it's on page 15, Roman numerals XV. He has this picture of the brain being blown up to the equivalent size of a car. And over the pineal gland in the third ventricle is a galaxy-like cloud. It looks like a UFO. This is actually your Nibiru, the planet of the crossing, that is within you. Once you cross, once the Kundalini crosses from the pineal gland to that particular mothership, your consciousness is expanded, you form this golden disc around your head, and you're actually able to do the things in which that we talk about through this particular technique known as the Macabre technique, even more so. So, at this particular breath technique, the 16 breath technique, you make a small hole with your lips, breathe out with pressure. This is at this point that the speed increases, and as you feel the speed increase, let out all your body with force. This action will cause the higher speed to be fully obtained and the macabre to be formed. So now we at the 17th breath technique. Now remember, we have 18 breath technique, 24 breath technique, and 28 breath technique. We just going through this one, which is this 18th breath technique. And actually, the 18th breath can't be taught, but I explain to you in a second here. But at the 17th breath technique, as you breathe in, you say to yourself in your head, 9/10 the speed of light. This is the code in which that tells your mind to increase the speed of the macabre to 9/10 the speed of light, which stabilizes the rotating fields of energy. What it does then is that this third-dimensional universe that we live in is turned to 9/10 the speed of light. And every electron in your body is rotating around every atom in your body at the 9/10 speed of light. And this is the reason that this particular speed is selected. Now, this speed increases to 9/10 the speed of light and it stabilizes the macabre, but it's the same as the breath 15 and 16. You make a small hole in your lips, breathe out with pressure, and as you feel the speed take off, you let all your breath out with force. You are now in your stable in the third-dimensional tune macabre. With the help of your higher self, you'll be able to understand what this really means. Now, for those who are unworthy, what happens is that at the 18th breath, this is a very special breath which is not taught here. You must receive this breath from your higher self. It is the breath that will make you, through the speed of light, into the fourth dimension or fifth dimension or higher. And you will disappear from this world and reappear in another. That will be your new home for a while. All right, this is what it says. So, supposedly during this 3 days and three nights of darkness, this is the reason why these particular techniques are taught, because it might come a time such as that where we might have to do that, or during these particular times in which that the earth goes through the so-called cataclysms or catastrophes in which that has been said that it might actually take place. So this is the reason for these particular techniques and which we're talking about tonight. And we're going to go to the phone line and see if there's any questions. Area code 314, you're on the line.
Islam Moore. This is Brother Ritter Hale, talking about the St. Louis, Missouri Republic. How you doing there, Brother Eileen?
Hi, doing well, doing well.
Yes, sir, brother. You went really kind of deep on me tonight.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir, brother. I was listening to you talking about the certain breathing techniques, how we can get ourselves in tune for the fourth and fifth dimensions that's about to come. Yeah, I was listening to what you were talking about, the certain aliens that a lot of people have been talking about since ancient times, how we can get ourselves prepared for this in order for them to see us, because they're not going to come down here in a cesspool and rescue us. You know, we have to evolve to a certain high level of consciousness. So I have been practicing on a lot of the breathing techniques that you have talked about on your earlier shows and lectures, and trying to get myself prepared, you know, for this event.
Right, exactly. Oh yeah, and the movie was K-Pax, exactly. Thank you, brother, brother Don. No doubt.
Yes,
I just
sir.
Wanted to get that in there too. That was the name of the movie in which that he said that he traveled here from his planet K-Pax to the planet Earth on a beam of light called a particle beam, or known as called tachyon energy.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, I have to really get it, you know, get involved in that. Because I haven't a lot of the stuff you were talking about, when you're talking about the Dogon and the I know the Dogon also go back to the as a man having the fishtail.
Right. Well, that was symbolic to Nomo, which was the Christ, in which that, you know, the Christians still use that symbol today, which is the fish on the back of the car. That was symbolic to the astrological age of Pisces, in which that we've been in for the last 2,000 years, and that we're about to exit from. Also, the fish symbolizes the sperm of man.
Mm-hmm.
That's the fish.
Oh, all that's right? the sperm of man.
Right, the sperm of man. Remember, there's only one sperm, in which that's the chosen sperm. That is symbolic to the Christ. That sperm in which that actually sparks the life within that particular egg, the nucleus of that egg, that is that one God or that one Christ force in which that forms the physical body into existence.
Okay.
Okay, so that's the fish that is also symbolic to that. Nomo is also symbolic to.
Okay. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
What do you say about the Pisces age now? Is it already ended, or it's going to end on December of this year? So
right. Well, it's been ending. So I mean, we actually are going through already. Now each age is about 2,160 years.
Uh-huh.
If you go through 26,000 year period, which is approximately 25,928 years to be right and exact. But it breaks down to about 2,160 years, all right? We're in the age of it ending now, all right? It is said that between the Gregorian and the Caesar calendar, there's over 521 years in which that is missing.
Okay.
So if that is the case, then actually, we're looking at, time being changed dramatically. And if that is the case, then we're looking at, supposedly, according to what the ancient states, that we are just finishing up a 25,000-year renewal of history. According to Elijah Muhammad, he called it a holy Quran, and is known as a great year. That means what happened is that the sun goes through the 12 zodiac sign along with Sirius constellation every 25,000 years, or 25,928 years, as he said, to be right in exact. Of course, that rounded off to 26,000, but that's the way in which that the ancients normally speaks about it. In which that Elijah Muhammad and many others have taken it to mean a holy Quran or a holy cycle or a sun cycle. Because that's what it is. That's what a holy Quran actually means, is a sun cycle.
Okay.
And
yeah,
so. Mm-hmm.
So I know a lot of the churches and the Christian, the Roman Church and the Vatican Church, I know they're trying to really hold on as much as possible, but really, what's really stalling everything. It's really is our people. Do you think? I mean.
Oh yeah, no doubt about it. It's because we're not being taught these particular breathing exercises and these sciences. So yeah, we are being stopped ourselves. We're stopping ourselves. We're stopping our own progress. We're blocking our own blessings or bliss, as we would say. You know, because blessings can also mean a blood sacrifice. But we're blocking ourselves.
So you know,
because we're participating in all these distractions.
And the biggest problem is that we're not ready.
Right, basically.
That's the man.
Well, as a masses, we're not ready.
As a masses,
But there's enough in order to make this quantum jump, you know, a quantum leap, you know, or metaphysics. You know, this metaphysical leap or this quantum physics leap, you know, we can do this.
So then in that case, then, a lot of our people will have to be left behind.
I mean that's what it appears to be. I mean, this is what is known as the rapture. This is what Matthew's 24th chapter and the ancients been talking about for a minute now. You know, is that some you see them, some you won't. So this is the part of the rapture thing that they're talking about. You know, as far as the ideology, it's being able to dematerialize and materialize at will.
Okay. Yeah, like I said, I've been, you know, keeping up with the breathing techniques and practices, you know, trying to, you know, get myself ready, you know, trying to change my diet, stuff, things like that.
Right,
you know,
right.
Trying to get in tune.
Right. Well, I mean, like you said the other week, that, you know, that they're trying to lock this down. And you know that these have to be, that all of this has to be true because of them having this war against us. You know, against humanity. They have a war against humanity. You know, and I'm talking about these so-called elite, you know, who aren't elite. You know, they're attached to these, like we said, the first and second astral plane beings. These beings from the first and second overtone of the astral plane attach themselves to these particular entities, you know, or mankind, you know, and they control them like puppets on a string to do their bidding.
So they're doing everything.
Right, and these beings are very jealous of humanity. They're very jealous of us getting ready to graduate into the fifth world, into the fifth dimension. So they're trying everything they can in order to hold this and stop this from occurring. As we spoke about the other week, the air you breathe now has chemtrails in it, which is loaded with aluminum, which is a forgetful agent that was used and discovered during World War II. With Hitler doing the experiments on the Nazis, on the Jews. Nazis doing experiments on the Jews. Also, what they found out is that, okay, your water, fluoride is in it. Another forgetful agent. Why is all these forgetful agents being added to the environment?
Evidently, they're trying to kill us off.
Well, not just to kill you off, to sterilize you, to lessen your lifespan, but also to make you forget. Why is it so important to forget? You know, the Willie Lynch shit didn't work well enough on a nigga. You know what? That didn't work well enough on a nigga? What? You know, somebody got to tell me something.
Well, see, they're getting really desperate now because they know their time is up.
Bingo. So then they go and do the food. You know, GMOs is in the food.
Even in your vegetables.
Right. So GMOs is known to be what? Genetically modified organisms. The word organism means a living thing.
That's right.
So it's there to genetically modify your DNA.
Boy.
So we got forgetful agents in the air, in the water, and now in the food to genetically modify the food to make you forget. To scramble your DNA, to lessen the telomere, which is the what lengthens will give you your lifespan, to lessen your telomere. This is what all of this is doing. You know.
So they're that desperate to go through all this extreme, you know.
Right. So if this shit isn't true, as the ancients and the indigenous people have been speaking about on the planet for, you know, hundreds and thousands of years, if this is not true in this day and time, then why you have to resort to these particular things? It doesn't make sense.
No, it don't.
So we know that we are, like Confucius said, Kung Tezu said, may your children live in interesting times. He's talking about this time right now. We are those children, and we are living in that interesting time period. This is what is going on. Huh. So we know for sure that that we have gifts in which that we're supposed to be exploiting right now, and these particular things, the air, the water, the food, is being warfare. It's warfare against us in order to keep this from transpiring, to keep these gifts from transpiring. Within the Bible, in the 1 Corinthians 12 chapter, is known as the 12 fruits, known as the 9 fruits of Christ. The gift of miracles, the gift of healing, the gift of prophecy, the gift of healing, the gift of speaking in tongues, the gift of interpreting tongues, the gift of faith, the gift of knowledge, so forth and so on. You're supposed to have all these gifts. That's what's supposed to be happening right now. So you're supposed to be able to see into the future and know what the things are going on. You're supposed to be able to produce miracles. You're supposed to be able to do healing, instantaneous. And all of these things are being blocked because of the air, the water, and the food in which that we are being contaminated by. This is no coincidence.
Boy. So they, I mean, so they're really scared. They're that scared. But yes. they're fighting a losing battle, though, you know?
Oh, no doubt it's a losing battle. They ain't going to win this shit. It's like Deborah Blair told us 20 years ago. It's like an ant trying to fight a tidal wave, a tsunami shit.
They can get hearts and all the rest of them weather controlling people all they want to, and it's still going to happen.
Right, exactly. But in order to make it happen, we have to learn how to do the science of breath, because breath, as we said before, eliminates 70% of the toxins produced in the body. It
right.
comes through the breath. 20% comes through the skin. 10% comes through the defecation and urination process. Well, we think we take a good shit, a good piss, oh, man, we just eliminated some toxins. We ain't done nothing.
See, I used to think that the more you have a bowel movement, the more you urinate, you get rid of a lot of out of your system.
Right. I mean, you're doing a 10% job, but you're not doing the 20 and the 70, which is 70, which is through the breath. And a person, if they're a shallow breather, then they definitely not getting enough oxygen into the lower lobes, the lower 5 lobes on the right, lower 4 lobes on the left, the lower 9 lobes, in order to produce enough toxin elimination.
So eliminated through the waste and urine, that's just, you know, you
so
just...
So the same thing, I can find him on there.
It's 10%, you know.
Right.
You just getting rid of just 10% of it, and that's it.
That's right.
And like, it's just, you know, just wasting your time if you're just going to do get rid of a lot of toxins out of your waste and urine, you know, and not dealing with breathing at all, you know.
Right, exactly. But hold on, Brother L, we're going to bring somebody else in here.
All right,
Eric Cole 747. Eric Cole 747, you're on the line.
Peace, bro.
Peace,
Doc.
Oh, yeah, I heard you say, this is Brother Roscoe. I heard you say that Holy Quran means a sun cycle, correct?
Right, because the word holy comes from the word halo or helios, which is the Greek, in which that has come from the word haru, which is heru, which heru means day, time, or sun. And then Quran actually is from the word chronos, in which that deals with an aspect of time also, as in cryology. All right? So Holy Quran in that sense, and also Quran itself means to recite in Arabic. And to recite something is to recycle, or which is a cycle itself. So in that regard, you know, so Holy Quran means some cycle.
True indeed. So my question is, what would you say the difference is between the Holy Quran of Mecca and the Holy Quran of the Moorish Sign Symbol of America?
Holy Quran of Mecca is a book in which that was produced through the influence of the Vatican. Because Muhammad, as we would say, was married to Khadija. And Khadija's uncle taught Prophet Muhammad about the Apocrypha and the different other books of the Bible. This is the Gabriel in which they were talking about, in which that supposedly read Ikra, read Muhammad, you know, all of this particular thing. These are all mythologies, these are all allegorical, but this is what it says that happened. Now, the Holy Quran, or the Moorish Holy Quran, Circle 7, that stems from, of course, the Aquarian Gospels of Jesus Christ, in which that actually are Rosicrucian texts from unto D.I. Grant, and portions of it come from a Tibetan text, in which that stems back to Akhenaten.
Huh. Oh, I know the piece on the Tibetan.
Wow.
I said I didn't know the piece on the Tibetan text.
Right. It goes back to a Tibetan text, in which that is derived from the ancient Kemetic text from Akhenaten, or Unk-Aten. Of the 18th dynasty.
Does it also deal with the Aquarian Gospel of Jesus the Christ?
Right. Portions of the Holy Quran, Circle 7, is the Aquarian Gospel of Jesus Christ, but other portions is that of Unto D.I. Grant, which is a Rosicrucian text, in which that stems back from a Tibetan text, in which that comes from and is derived from, as I said, from Akhenaten, Unk-Aten, from the 18th dynasty. In other words, is an ancient Egyptian writer, which the Rosicrucians say that they come from and stem from the Akhenaten.
Wow.
So that's why it's called Moorish science, because you're dealing with the Moors. Matter of fact, the high priest during that time period was called Moors, M-A-U-R, Moor. And it was known as the high priest of Anu, which is actually a form of Amen. In which that Akhenaten was known originally as Amenhotep IV, who studied that same school.
To deal with the book of Enoch as well.
Any book in which that is coming from the Apocrypha, you have the lost books of the Bible, the forgotten books of Eden, and you have the Apocrypha. As well as also portions of these books are within the Catholic text. The Catholics have 73 books, while the Protestant Christians only have 66. They have the Book of Esdras, the Jubilee books, and the books of Maccabees that are in the Catholic book of 73. While the Protestants, who have 66, is based on something else. You have 33 generations from Adam to Jesus, and then 33 generations from Jesus, from Adam to David is 33 generations, and then from David to Jesus is 33 generations, hence 66. And then, of course, you have 33 vertebrates in your back, which is called the Digid, or Jedi, in which that is known as the backbone of Osiris, or Osar. And you have 31 plus two nerves, which is 33, in which that 31 nerves go up inside of the spinal column, and then two nerves crisscross outside, which is known as the caduceus, as in the science of healing, or the symbol of healing, or the emblem of healing, in which that is on the hospitals. Hence, 33 plus 33 is 66. So the Bible itself, within the Protestant, was broken down by King James, who was the head of the United Grand Lodge of England in the 1500s. Excuse me, 1600s.
Yeah, I'm still dealing with that part where you said that King James was a Moor.
Right. Just do more research. I got my website that is getting ready to come out real soon, and you'll see the pictures and everything that we got on.
Okay.
As well as also William Shakespeare, known as Francis Bacon. He was a Moor too.
Hmm. Wow.
Now don't excuse niggerism. You know, if they did some niggerism shit, you know, then they still did it. You know, but I don't think that everything in which that has been said concerning them is true. Of course not. I think a lot of it is disinformation and misinformation purposely in order to throw us off the track of what, you know, the Bible and what, you know, America was really was going to be founded and built upon. Because William Shakespeare, known as Francis Bacon, actually wrote the book called New Atlantis, in which that dealt with coming over here to the New World.
Yeah, I'm really glad you said that, because I never really get a full understanding of the New Atlantis book.
Right.
Because half of it was written in Greek or Latin, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
And the other half was written in English, or Old English, I'll put it that way.
Right.
And I'm just now really grasping to the Old English language.
Right.
I mean, knowing how to read it.
Mm-hmm. I got you.
Because I see certain V's. Right. They're used.
Right. But the premise of the book itself was speaking about setting up a new kingdom here in the Western world, in which that would be able to be expanded upon as far as the unification principles of religion, of philosophy, of thought. This is why the original principles that the Europeans first had, and which they gave them, was based on freedom of religion, freedom of expression. Because these are more science criteria.
That's how it became.
Right. Then all of a sudden, the Vatican looped them into their submission hole and became a Christian corporation. And now every president that comes along got to expound some Christian shit.
And that's how you said freedom of expression. That's how it became the Constitution. Really,
right.
It was a Moorish.
Right.
Moorish law.
Right. Well, the Constitution was based on the peace treaty of the Iroquois Confederation, in which that is a known fact that Thomas Jefferson and supposedly Benjamin Franklin sat with the Iroquois Confederates and took portions of their teachings and of their documents and put it within the Constitution, and then had certain other people in order to put the Constitution together. Now, there's new news in which that it says that that it was actually that the Vatican also had their hand inside of the Constitution, which I can't say that they really did, because, you know, their premise is that of control, you know, through the Christian means, you know,
right.
In some regard. You know, even if it comes out to something else, they still want to dictate policy through the Christian manner. And the Constitution, being that is, you know, was based on freedom of religion, don't express Christian values in that regard. That's part of a free thinking system or society.
Right.
You know, so, you know, there's certain things in which that's being said in which that, you know, we have to go back and analyze, you know, and do more research. And that's the key. I love this shit.
Okay.
All right, we got other callers coming in. Peace.
Peace.
Yes, peace. How you doing?
That ain't me.
What's up, Bob?
Peace.
Yes, peace. How you doing?
That ain't me.
What's up,
Bob?
Peace.
Peace. Peace, this Messiah.
Peace, Messiah. What's up, God?
Peace. What's going on, brother?
Not much. What's up with you?
It threw me off a little bit because I got it also on
right,
online.
Right. Turn it down before you can hear me.
Yeah. Turn the online joint off. Yeah, it's a little delay on there.
Exactly.
All right, the OMEX. This is a little bit off topic, but
right.
It's still on topic, of course.
Right. Don't worry, we're going to tie it together.
I got the gods in the building. We in here four deep. I got the God of Allah's son in here. I got Be Knowledge. And I got the God Elevation in here. We in here building. And we listening to Blog Talk. you know, going over this Ouachita science.
Mm-hmm.
We got a question in, as far as the Aboriginal name of the ancient ones before they took on the name Omec.
That was the She people. She, X-I, She.
All right, you hit it right on the money, Lord.
She people,
right. Right, X-I, She. That's how it's pronounced. It's She, like yo, she, you know, yo, she's real nice, yo. You know, like, you know, She. So that's how it is pronounced with She. But they are direct descendants of the Dogon.
Okay.
Of course, the Dogons were the ancient Egyptians. You know, the 6,000 BC, as we said earlier, and they left out of Kemet around, which was 8,000 years ago, and they went into westward, you know, into Mali.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and from them came forth, you know, the Omecs, which are the Mandes or the Mandingo people.
And the Omecas, yes.
Right. And they was known as the She people. But when they came to the Americas, because they cut down so much rubber trees, the word Omeka or Omec became synonymous to them and their job and which that they was doing, which was cutting down trees, rubber trees.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, that was one of the imports and exports of that day, was rubber. And we controlled that.
Mm-hmm.
And this was 5,000 years ago.
And now, another question in regard to that as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Omecs. I mean, pardon me, the Dogon.
Mm-hmm.
Same descent from the Sirius star system.
Right.
Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah. If you get the book Sirius Mysteries by Robert Temple or Sirius Connections by Murray and Hope, in both books, as well as also Pell Fox, in all three books, they speak about the fact that the Dogon states that we came from the star constellation Sirius.
Sirius, yeah.
Right, mm-hmm. And in particular, Sirius B, as
Sirius
a matter
B,
of fact. Outright, which is called... Right.
They run it until they told them,
and they put them right. Telescopes.
Right, Polo Solo, exactly. And yeah. This particular, our solar system, our sun actually is, and was formed from the implosion of Sirius B.
Mm-hmm.
So actually you're in the alternate... parallel universe.
Mm-hmm.
But the same shit that happened on Sirius B is happening still here now, because it actually was formed from the implosion or the memories of that particular sun, and it was transformed into our sun today. This is what was known as within the Gnostic scripts as Idolabroth breaking out from the womb of Sophia. Sophia symbolized Sirius or Set.
Mm-hmm.
And Idolabroth symbolized, in a sense, Set.
Oh, so. Mm-hmm.
In which that broke out of the womb too early. So Sophia told Idolabroth that there was another god in which that existed prior to you.
Right in the Gnostic scriptures.
Mm-hmm. Right. And it's the same tale of, because you have Horus, the babe, but you also have Horus, the elder.
Mm-hmm.
The elder existed prior to Set, but he couldn't understand that because he was looking at his creation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's that same story is told within the Dogon with Amma. Amma had a child called had a child by the name of Nogo, Anugo. And Nugo is Idolabroth. And Nugo broke away from Amma. And so Amma told, which is, you know, somebody to the mentor of Royette, the female counterpart to Ra, told Nugo that there was one who existed prior to you. And that became Nomo. And Nomo is the Christ. Just like Heru is the Christ. You know,
right.
Another, this mythology within the various scriptures, whether it's the Dogon, whether it's the Gnostic.
Variant.
Right. It all tells the same tale over and over again.
Dude, it's the tale within as without, God.
Right.
That's,
exactly.
It's telling the tale of itself.
No doubt.
That's where it all relates to, where it all comes from. And that's why it's so important, God, is what you're doing right now, adding on the knowledge to the cipher. And I want to say peace and happy New Year's, October 10th, when the brothers came into the knowledge and the cipher seen the truth.
Word.
And we still adding on that knowledge to the cipher.
No doubt.
Right now, brothers just have to study.
Yes, sir.
God, once you tell me something, I could be a cipher to see the truth. I still have to study, God. How I'm going to see it unless I take it through knowledge, wisdom, understanding. You know, I've got to take it to knowledge, the born, wisdom, born, understanding, born, in order for me to see that truth.
No doubt, God, because you got to make it born. You got
to apply it.
Exactly.
And that's what it's all about. God's sovereignty is about applying it, being the captain of the ship. The captain, he stay and go down with the ship. That's applying it like a motherfucker.
No doubt. No doubt.
Peace, God. I just wanted to say
peace,
that to
God.
You.
Peace and love to you, God.
Peace and love, God.
Peace is a law. Peace.
Peace, God.
Peace. I appreciate the answers.
All
I appreciate you already know I appreciate everything.
No doubt, God.
Peace and fraternal greeting.
Peace and fraternal greeting, God.
Peace.
All right, we got area code 747. Area code 747, you're on the line. Peace.
Peace.
Yes.
Oh, no, I'm already asking my question about the whole
thing. Oh, okay,
court. I don't know what happened.
All right. Thanks. We're going to area code 916. Area code 916, you're on the line.
Peace, brother.
Peace.
Peace. Oh, my God, I
peace,
finally got to talk to you. This is Sister Morena.
Peace.
Peace. Dr. Aleem, I've been looking at your lectures since 2009. You guided me to the Tao of Sexology and from Stephen Chang all the way down to the Jewel and the Lotus, your teacher.
Right.
I also ended up going into the I bought some other tantric books and sexual sorcery. I tell you, I went crazy with it. You know, I haven't gotten a chance to read them all yet, but when it comes to the reflexology, the Tao of Sexology, and all this other, I was able to get those down. You know, but anyway, that's not the reason why I called. First off, I'm sending so much love to you, and thank you so much for your vast amount of knowledge. You are a phenomenal teacher. Phenomenal.
I appreciate that. Appreciate that. Thank you.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You.
Are you still in North Carolina?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. My family's out there and stuff, so I try and get out there as much as I can. But anyway, I was looking at your show topic. I'm not able to catch up with you as much as I want to because of my working and everything. But I looked at your show topic, and I had a question about my experiences. Since 2010, I've been seeing, like, these little white dots. And since then, it's some, you know, the white dots still come around, but then also the blue dots. I see, like, blue imprints, blue dots, and even I've seen some streaks as well. And I don't know what it is. I said, is there something wrong with me? But I don't think so. I don't think so. I'm very healthy.
How large are they?
I'm sorry?
How large are these dots?
How large are they? They're like little stars. They're not
like little
stars. Specs. They're little, you know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, I got you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What those are, what is known as the star particles. We spoke about earlier that 300,000 tons of star dust energy or particles fall to the planet Earth daily.
Wow.
So what you are doing is you are able to tap into seeing those particular particles.
Wow.
Okay. Actually, as a matter of fact, it says when we look at a wave, it transforms into a particle. You know, so actually we're looking at certain wavelengths. That's what we're tapping into, but when we look at it and see it, it transforms from a wave to a particle. And so that's what you're seeing on these particular particles.
Oh, my goodness. You know what's even more crazy about it is, you know, I see them around people.
Right.
And then also my mother, I see them around my mother all the time.
Right. So that's because they're melanated beings. Our job is to absorb these particular star particles or cosmic dust. so that we can expand our life force, because as scientists has already stated that we are a walking star. Mm-hmm. Our physical body is composed of stardust. So the more stardust we can bring in, the more lengthier our lifespan and healthier we are.
Wow. Is there any websites or books that I can research?
Yeah, my book, Out of the Womb, Enter the Mind.
Out of the Womb, Enter the Mind.
Right, Outer, O-U-T-E-R, oh. Out of the Womb, and then Enter, I-N-N-E-R, Enter the Mind.
Enter the Mind. Okay. Mm-hmm. Writing this down. Okay. And your website is, what is your website again? I went there once.
It's www.cultural, that's C-U-L-T-R-A-L, cultural-freedom.com.
Oh, right, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Cultural-freedom.com.
Great. Okay. All right, brother. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, doctor. So many blessings to you.
I appreciate you. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
All right, you're going to area code 832.
Hey, I got some other stuff I'm going to.
Area code 832. Peace.
Peace, family.
Peace, God.
Peace, brother.
Brother Talib calling in from Houston.
Please, brother.
I just want you to touch in on a little bit on Horace Greeley. Horace Greeley a little bit, and
right.
Someone else. I just know you can go in on this subject. You know,
right,
what I'm saying.
Right. Just mm-hmm.
touch on that a little bit, and
just
some people asking me some questions, just tuning in. I know you can really go in on it. And just he's just going on that. That's gonna connect the dots for a lot of
all
people.
Right. Well, Horace Greeley was started from right here out of North Carolina. As a matter of fact, not too far from where I'm located at today, in which that he put together his printing press, in which that he put a newspaper out, in which that dealt with reconstruction of history.
I'm tripping. Long
in which that the information that he utilized was basically based on reconstruction of history. And it was Horace Greeley in which that during this so-called reconstructive period, you know, downplayed a lot of the progress in which that was being made, in which that eventually led, after the reconstructive period with the Jim Crow's laws, in which that was seen all the way up until the 60s. You know, that basically came through him and his newspaper.
Hello?
Yes, we're here.
Oh, okay. I'm just grabbing some stuff out of Whole Foods. I didn't catch the last thing you said.
Yeah, we were saying that it is basically through Horace Greeley's newspapers that we've seen the Reconstruction era.
And isn't it 580 years or whatnot? And the Etruscans, and
right.
It's basically the Etruscans and the real true Greeks, because when you do a lot of your correspondence and you do a lot of your studies, you know, they always revert to the Greek, and a lot of people
right.
don't know who the original Greeks are, you know.
Right, well, that's what you're talking about, the Reconstruction period, in which that he dealt with the Reconstruction of history through his newspaper.
Right,
and,
right.
That's how he was able to do it, through his newspaper. And
oh,
so,
and one... Oh, and one more thing, and it's very powerful. The television has always been powerful, and a lot of people don't know about, most people in the country know about the Black Wall Street, but actually the thing that really jumped off the Black Wall Street was a movie, you know, and you know, television really does, it is a big part, and it really does shape your perception and your subconscious. And that's what really got a lot of those Europeans riled up, was that I can't remember the film, but it was a Ku Klux Klan film.
Yeah,
and
television.
You know, they've been working on our psyche for the longest. You know?
Right.
I mean not our psyche, but dealing with people's subconscious. This science for the longest, so I just want you to go a little bit on that, touching on that, if you don't mind.
Yeah, well, I mean, you're talking about the media or entertainment, of course, has been utilized in order to project white supremacy, you know, white images into the minds and the psyche of, you know, of the so-called oppressed people, therefore causing the dichotomy and the strife of that great jihad or Armageddon within itself, you know, of the as W.E.B. Du Bois wrote about the two souls of black people, you know, in which that he spoke about one in which that wants to adapt and integrate, and the other one in which that saying that how detrimental the integration process would actually be, you know, if we didn't, you know. In order to get us to do that, we had a controlled educational system. As we've seen during the 60s, it was a forced, you know, exercise, you know, of integration.
Right.
You know, so anything that's been coerced in that manner or in that regard. And as you've seen, over the famous, you know, Dr. King was a Boulay member, you know, and a lot of the people who was working behind the scenes during that time period during the 1960s was Boulay, you know.
Right.
Those are the advisors to the kings, and the kings are symbolic to the Rockefellers.
Right,
you know,
right.
And the Rothschilds in the Eastern Hemisphere.
Right. Whenever you check out those coat of arms, it all traces back to us. You know.
Exactly. But that's where you see the birthright has been stolen.
Exactly. Can't run from it. You know?
No.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You cannot. And just like, you know, I mean, just like earlier you was talking about, you know, a correlation with the crown. And, you know, the correlation with the crown, you already know about the IRS, the correlation with the Inquisition Revenue Service. But, you know, as the straw man is created, as, you know, a lot of people, you know, in the Moorish community understand the term ex-relatone, you know, and you're going to be an ex-rel because you'll always be the co-beneficiary of it because you didn't create it. And that goes back to Rome because they created, you know, the system, you know, just get down and lay down, you know, that's how they rock. You know, so, yeah, I just seen a book, you know, they really pushing this thing about stop bullying and all that, you know, the irony in that, as buses that be passing by, stop the bullying and stuff, you know what I'm saying? It's crazy.
Right.
You know, I really appreciate the work you're doing, and your vibration is being felt. I wish, like every other, a lot of other brothers, hope to build a foundation in their city or a land bridge to keep connecting with all the other brothers, so. You know, salute
no
to everybody that's doing
the
work.
No doubt. We definitely have to give thanks. All right, we got area code 614. Area code 614, you're on the line. Peace. Area code 614, peace, God.
Can you hear me, fam?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yes, sir. This is Insight, man. How you been, brother?
He's up.
Yes, sir. I got a quick question, man. I know you're busy. You're about to shut it down for the night. I want to get back into the King James piece that you went about. Went
right.
In on. You touched on it last week, and you got back into it tonight about how he was a Moor and the whole nine. And this was groundbreaking information. I never heard this before. But you said something on last week's show that really, you know, stuck out to me. I've been telling people forever. When we look at his version of the Bible, it's the most popular version of the Bible that's out there.
Yes,
and
sir.
I always made the point to always tell people, like, why did he leave certain things in there, like, you know, about Jesus' hair like lamb's wool and his eyes like fire and skin like grass? Like, if they really wanted to whitewash the whole joint,
exactly.
him and Shakespeare and all them cats could have really did that. And it was intriguing that they didn't. But my question to you is, if he was a Moor, then what's the science behind the other book that he wrote after they redid the Bible, his demonology joint?
Right. Well, when you read the book about demonology, it was a book about witchcraft in which that was going on during that time period in England and elsewhere. You know what I'm saying? Remember, he was also the king of Scotland, the king of Ireland, the king of England, all at the same time.
Right.
So he was talking about the things in which that was taking place during that time period. And remember, he also was the United Grand Lodge Grand Master. So So he had access to all of that information, you know, dealing with demonology.
Right.
You know, and so it was a book in which that was written about, you know, those particular sciences, you know. I'm pretty sure that he had to have done more writing in which that they don't speak about.
Right.
You know, I'm pretty sure that he did the opposite of the demonology, you know, dealing with angels.
Right,
you know,
right.
Because it'll only have to be able to be balanced. You know, if you're going to speak about, you know, the particular angels or, you know, the 72 demons or, you know, or the cherubims, you know, up under the control of of God, you know, you had to speak about them, then you also had to speak about the 72 angelical beings under God, too, you know, in which that was dealing with the seraphim side and not just the cherubim. You know, in other words, not just the negative, but also the positive. You know, so, you know, it's just about doing more research, you know, based on this information. I mean, of course, this is, you know, I heard about King James being, you know, a Moor for the last 20-some-odd years through the Hebrew Israelites.
Right.
You know, but I didn't have enough information in order to verify it, you know, and the way in which that they was explaining it, I just knew that, you know, it had to be Moor. You know, but I always wondered too, you know, as a child, you know, about, you know, the hair like lamb's wool and, you know, so forth.
Right.
So why those characteristics was kept in the Bible. You know what I'm saying? Judah being dark like being black like unto the ground.
Right.
You know, all of these things are kept in there. You know, Ethiopia is just like unto Israel to me. You know, speaking, you know, God is saying that Ethiopia is just like Hebrew or Israel unto him. You know, why
right.
all of that, you know, all of that is in there. And then the river of the Garden of Eden comes up through Ethiopia or Cush.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, what all these references to us is still there. So if you're right. If they wanted to whitewash it, then you know all of that definitely could have been changed.
Right. I mean, just I always was. It was funny to me and how they could have said that. You know, when Mary and Joseph took Jesus, they took him to Egypt. They could have said he in Europe or something. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like that was always intriguing me. I'm gonna get out of here, fam. We back on air next Sunday, man. The Insightful Hour is back. I'm gonna be calling you and the Queen. Jump on the show as usual once every 2 or 3 months, man, to bless us with these jams, man. Keep doing the work, Aleem. I love you, boy. And I'll be down in North Carolina real soon, fam. Look for me in the next 6 months.
All right, God, we definitely will. Appreciate you, Brother Morgan.
All right, appreciate you, family.
Peace,
right,
peace, brother.
All right, area code 347. Area code 347, you're on the line. New York,
great show.
Peace.
Peace.
Great. Hello?
Yes, greetings. We here.
Oh, okay, great show. I want to know about the interview for the person who does the colonics at the spa. And
yep, this is Brother Moore.
When?
This coming Wednesday.
Okay, thank you. 9 p.m.?
Yep, 9 p.m. is good.
What happened last week?
Technical difficulties. I can't get in.
Oh,
fact,
okay.
Everybody
yeah.
got cut off, and so I had to do. I had to do
yeah.
it through the phone with the brother to finish it up.
Oh, okay. So next Wednesday, 9 p.m.
Yep. Next Wednesday, 9
All
p.m.
Right. Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Peace.
Peace.
All right. We're getting ready to head out. Appreciate you, Brother L. Once again, for coming on, helping us out, getting
anytime time, more.
You know what I'm saying, more? Appreciate you. And
yes, thank you.
Get ready to head out of here.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intentions straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.